from Bandai Namco Entertainment, and I'm here with Cody and Laura. They have just finished playing the demo of Little Nightmares here at PAX East 2017. So Cody and Laura, I have a couple of questions for you. What did you think of Little Nightmares?
It was actually a lot of fun. It was a good problem-solving game, and it did a good job of not holding your hand.
Yeah, a lot of fun, and the graphics are really good, too.
I thought it was fantastic. I really felt like I was there, and I was getting really spooked out from everything.
I also really like the use of sound in the game to sort of hit on what you may be supposed to do or what you should watch out for. So that's really great, and I think it creates a really good experience.
It was really intense for me, but I like it because my adrenaline was pumping. So I was excited, but I was also scared at the same time, and I didn't know what was going to happen next.
It was a lot more tense than I thought it would be. You know, it's really, really atmospheric.
Definitely that evasion and hide, and then you get like your heart pumping a little bit. You're like, oh, he's gonna catch me.
I absolutely love it. I love Little Nightmares. I found out about it through Twitch and on social media, and I came to PAX East just to play it.
I really liked it. A little bit creepy though, but pretty cool. Probably will get nightmares tonight, probably little ones though.
I love the mystery of it. I love the graphics. The graphics are awesome. There's monsters, there's puzzles. It's absolutely amazing.
Very interesting, complicated puzzle platformer. Generally puzzle platformers I can figure out, but it was a few cases in there where I was wandering around the room where I had to try it two or three times.
If you could describe Little Nightmares in one word, what would it be?
Spectacular.
Discovery.
Exhilarating.
Weird, strange, beautiful, and exciting.
After playing the demo, are you going to pick up the game?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, for Xbox One.
Yes, definitely. I'm going to buy it the minute it comes out on PS4.
Oh yeah, I already pre-ordered it.
I would definitely get this game.
I'm definitely going to my game store, and I'm putting a reserve down on that. And I definitely recommend it to anyone who likes gaming, any age. I definitely think that's the game for you, and you're absolutely going to love Little Nightmares.
Good afternoon, everybody. Happy Friday. We're here on the 28th of April, Little Nightmares Day. Woo! Super excited for the launch of Little Nightmares today. I'm here with Kasumi, one of the brand managers on Little Nightmares, as well as Ray, one of the producers on Little Nightmares. We're here at the Bandai Namco Entertainment America office. We want to show you a little bit of the game. We also want to show you the collector's edition, do some giveaways. So how the giveaways are going to work, guys, is we're doing two separate giveaways. There's a Gleam giveaway, and that's for actually for the collector's edition. We're going to give away a PS4 and an Xbox One version after the stream. So if you go on there, sign up and follow some of our channels, you have a higher chance of getting the item. And then we're also going to be giving away codes for the game throughout the stream. So I'm gonna give two PS4 codes, two Xbox codes, and two Steam codes throughout the hour. So first off, I wanna just get right into the collector's edition. The collector's edition is available on PS4 and Xbox One. That's $34.99. Check your local retailers to see if you're available. They're going fast. A lot of people are really excited about this. So let's get into it. It's got this sweet little overlay that looks like a prison. Where six is. And then inside the box, this is the fun part. We've got the figurine of six with her famous yellow coat and her little lighter. That's how she sees in the maw. Awesome. It's 10 centimeters tall. And also inside the box, we have the game itself, of course. And inside the game, inside here, you have the soundtrack as well as the game itself. You also have this awesome poster of artwork from the game. It's, give me one second here. It's six looking at two of the chefs. That looks like a bad situation. I don't think she's gonna make it out of that one alive.
I think she will. She definitely
Sumi's will. Confident.
Best twins in the world.
And then finally, there's some stickers as well. Just different characters from the game, the chef, you have the janitor, six climbing up different stuff. You also have the gnome, the fan favorite gnome there. Awesome.
You know, it should also be noted that if for those of you that are really into like physical goods, this is the only way right now that you can get a physical copy of the game. Yes. In the US.
So yeah, it's a really great collector's edition. A lot of cool items in there. You know, if you're a fan of the character, you know, we've been seeing online that everyone's really in love with the character of six, the character design. So you can bring your own six home, put her up on your desk, and she'll light your way home. Cool, so I think we'll start it off. Now that I did that, I'm gonna start it off by just giving away a code. The way I'm gonna do it is you just gotta stay active in the chat, ask us questions, to the brand manager, as well as the Ray, the producer.
A producer,
and we will pick you. So I'm gonna roll it up. First roll, Buquifios. You just won a PlayStation 4 code. Ooh. For Little Nightmares.
Congratulations.
So, congratulations, man. Awesome. Cool, so I think we're gonna jump into the game. Ray's gonna be taking the sticks here. The way that we're gonna do it is we're just gonna start a new game and start it from the beginning. So, Ray, tell us a little bit about kind of the intro of the game and kind of how it starts.
Well, it's all actually really mysterious. The game doesn't really offer much in the way of story. It's a lot of it you have to figure it out, or mm-hmm. it's inferred. The game starts as mysterious as it ends. It kind of just happens. Six is gonna wake up in like a little makeshift bed suitcase, and from there you go. You don't really know anything of what's going on.
Yeah.
You don't know where you are.
It's more of visual storytelling. The world itself kind of tells the user, you know, the emotion that they're feeling, kind of the feelings that overall.
The game is very much mood centric, visual and a sense of it's supposed to, the world communicates itself to you by the feeling it gives you, but there's no text in the game. No one's ever going to say anything. No one's ever going to tell you what's going on. It's more up to you. It's like, how does this section make you feel?
Yeah.
And then there is a narrative that you can kind of determine for yourself.
Yeah, it's kind of open-ended. The user, the player himself, kind of infers based on the experience they had in the world.
Yeah. I remember the first time I kind of played this game all the way through, and then, you know, what I determined to be the story, I was like, wow, that's pretty dark.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if everyone else is going to come up with that same conclusion, since the game doesn't tell you. But, you know, talking with the guys back at Tarsier, you know, they're very, very intentional about how much they wanted to tell you about what's going on.
Yeah. No, it's a really interesting style. You know, it's not overt storytelling. I like that.
Yeah.
It doesn't hold your hand, really. It just kind of puts the player in the world. The world's called the Maw. It's this interesting kind of ship slash prison slash, you know.
I mean, it could be whatever you think it is, yeah. But all you know is that it's deep below the waves.
Yeah. You know it's dark, you know it's cold, and you know that Six, the little girl character, is in a tough situation. So.
Yeah, yeah.
But you don't know how.
Yeah.
You just know that there's stuff lurking in the darkness.
Awesome.
Right. Are the guys on the feed getting the audio? Because the audio is like really,
they're hearing the audio. Yeah, so. Yeah. So maybe you could talk a little about the atmospherics, the audio, the music. I know the team at Tarsier, who's the developer, did a lot of work to make sure to build kind of this atmosphere, the feeling of the Maw.
Yeah. So just like the visuals, the soundtrack, the audio is not in your face. It's all very subtle, it's all very subliminal. Like things will come and hit you at certain points of the game, but there's not going to be any like constant music going on. If you do hear music, you're not sure if that's the game that's playing the music for you, or if it's the background, or if it's something there like a music box that's playing.
Yeah.
So it's all very, very much meant to just evoke some kind of feeling out of
you.
Yeah. It's very atmospheric, so it kind of sets the tone. It really pulls you into the game. You feel like you're there with all of the sound effects and the occasional music.
Yeah. Maybe you could talk a little bit to kind of the mechanics, kind of some of the stuff you're doing. I know, you know, similar to the figurine, Six has her trusty lighter. That's her real light source in the game.
Yeah.
And I know you just pick something up. Maybe you could talk about kind of that mechanic for the puzzle.
Yeah, so the game doesn't really tell you a whole lot of what's going on. Again, a lot of it's meant for you to figure out. Like what you just saw, I picked up a figurine. The game doesn't say collect these because, you know, it's a sub-objective of the game.
Yeah,
but. You know, that's what they're there for. You find all the dolls, and then you'll earn some kind of achievement or trophy in that situation. But the gameplay is fairly basic. There's a lighter to help you see that's used in certain situations as far as gameplay as well. But it's run, jump, crawl, grab. Very old school Prince of Persia like. A lot of those type of very classic platforming type moves.
And would you say there's kind of almost an element of hide and seek, I know, in the game, right? There's big creatures. Six is obviously a very small character. She's a little girl.
Yeah.
She's in this really overwhelming, frightening world. And I know there's a lot of different monstrous creatures that are lurking in this world that are trying to get her. So she obviously has no defense. She has no weapon.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of the game is kind of sneaking, hiding, making sure you jump up on somewhere they can't get you.
There's no, she's helpless in this game. There's no real offense, or there is no offense for her.
This is a cheery moment here.
It's something that you don't really know why this happened. It just happened, but you know, fortunately, you have the chair there for you.
Obviously, that character wasn't as strong as Six. He just said, I'm out. The Maw's too much.
Right, but basically, anyone that you come across, you'll need to find a, use your head to find a way to get around them, get by them, whether through sneaking or distraction such, because you can't face any of them. They're all meant to overpower you. So you are this helpless girl that's playing this game, but that's kind of like the fear of that. That is one of the elements of fear that we're tapping into this game,
this
fear of helplessness. But, you know, she is self-sufficient, self-reliant, so with enough perseverance and creativity, you can get through any of the enemies in this particular game.
Yeah, I know Tarsier and the team worked a lot to kind of play to the childhood fears, right? That's kind of a big part of the atmosphere as we're talking about.
Yeah,
so helplessness is obviously a childhood fear. You know, as a child,
fear of the dark.
Fear of the dark.
Fear of the unknown.
Yeah, fear of giant creatures trying to chase you. I don't know if that's a common fear, but I don't know. I remember having frightening nightmares.
I've had fears like that when I was younger. That's for sure.
Yeah.
I think one of the greatest things about this game is really, you know, kind of the whole environment, because not only is it dark and scary, but it's supersized. You're so small, but everything
is
super
cool
big.
Aspect, excuse me.
Yeah, it's very, it makes me feel even smaller than I already am, you know?
So going back to the childhood fears, maybe we could talk about some of our childhood fears. Ray, what were some of the things that really spooked you when you were a kid?
I spent a lot of my time living kind of out in the country, as far as living in California can be the country.
Yeah.
And there were a lot of bees and yellow jackets. I really had gained a hatred for bees, because I'd be out playing and one would land on my face.
Yeah,
you can't move because
oh my gosh.
I remember learning from this old horror movie called, I think it was called Bees or something, that if you breathe on them, that's when they get all pissed off. I don't know if that's true. But I remember being...
Well, we learn everything from movies, so...
Being like five or six and being really scared of bees landing on my face. It happened a lot.
When I was a an adult and not a kid, I stepped on a bee, so I have a very very big fear of
bees.
Similar
fear.
Oh, right.
I'm also not a child.
What about young Sumi?
Sumi? Oh, man. Young Sumi was afraid of a lot of things, all right? Young Sumi was afraid of... So I have older brothers, and they loved video games, and that's kind of where I got my love of video games from, and they played video games that featured zombies. So I've had a childhood fear
of zombies,
okay. But that also meant that I was afraid of the dark. So when it was really dark and I could hear noises like creaking wood or anything, I would be like, oh man, yeah. There's a zombie there? All right.
That's I think half the fear when you're a kid. Your imagination is so large that when you start to hear things, you manifest any. It's always you always go to that one thing like, oh, it's gotta be a zombie.
It's gotta be zombie.
Yeah, yeah.
What about you, Dalton?
I was definitely afraid of just.
Oh, watch out.
The unknown. You know, you sit in your bed. It's dark.
No.
Uh oh, first death.
Yeah, it's gonna happen.
Obviously, this game is pretty brutal. There's a lot of ways for Six to meet her demise.
Yeah.
But right. She perseveres. She comes back. What about the chat? What are some of the big fears of the, in the chat? Maybe we can throw
zombies.
Zombies.
Bees that are zombies. Undead bees. That is pretty frightening. So what are these creatures called here? Right?
These are leeches.
Leeches.
Leeches. Yeah.
That's a rational fear. A leech, a parasite. That's something that I've always had a little bit of fear. I hate worms. I always since I've been a kid. Worms.
Like the earthworms.
Just worms in general always kind of weirded me out.
You can't hear it from where we're playing, but from the, I hope that the stream can hear. But yeah, the leeches make this weird, really creepy noise. They screech at you.
That is pretty creepy. Yeah. So I'm seeing some in the chat, some fears.
All right.
We've got fear of chickens.
Oh, that's a pretty.
Those are pretty scary.
I lived on a farm and. Some chickens will chase you. Geese, too. If you look back at them, they will chase you.
And we got dolls. That's a pretty irrational fear.
Oh, there's a section in this game.
There's some dolls in this game
right
there.
All right. You pick up the game. Face your childhood fears.
Yeah. Who was that? That was Wayward Umbra. I think you need to pick up Little Nightmares. Face your fears. Take on the doll section. We've got Scared of Heights. Fear of Heights. That's
a good one.
Six is also pretty scared of heights. I know she can, there's fall damage in this game, so you can definitely break her fragile body.
And you know, it's kind of brutal in the way that it happens too, because she's still a fragile little girl. And when she hits, there's some audio accompaniment and a big piano thud that just is a bit jarring.
Run.
Oh, there's a great section of like audio design here. When you open that door.
Oh, the light.
For no real reason, as the light starts to shine through the door, this weird organ music starts to play that starts getting louder and louder as you open the...
Oh, wow.
I remember the first time I actually got that in a build, one of my feedback was to Tarsier was like, this is fantastic sound design. Like, it doesn't really make sense. There's no organ nearby, but it's kind of almost like a creepy, like, la, and then as the door
ominous.
Opens. Yeah, it's very ominous.
It's very ominous,
yeah,
right.
So there's a lot of little notes like that throughout the game. So
I gotta say the lighting in this game is just fantastic. I love how atmospheric it is. How different things are spotlighted, certain things are dark. You never really fully understand the space that you're in. It's almost like Willy Wonka's nightmare.
There's also variance in where you are. Like, for instance,
this is
huge and wide open, and sometimes you're crawling through those vents and it's really small and compact. So you if you have a fear of big spaces, fear of small spaces, don't worry. This game's got that covered for you.
There was a lot of experimentation that was done over the course of development. So right now we kind of settled on this, not necessarily, it's not drab, because depending on who you are, there's a lot of color, but there's a lot of high contrast that goes
on. Definitely high contrast. I mean, her raincoat pops so well in the world.
She's meant to.
Yeah.
But the darks are really dark, the brights are pretty bright, and there's a lot of lighting going on. But there were some things that had been experimented upon. I mean, early versions of the game had sort of a, kind of a filter that was running through post-processing over the screen to kind of give it a fuzzy look or kind of like
grainy film.
A grainy look.
Yeah.
And it was felt it kind of took away. It added a certain particular mood that worked for a while, but I think it was chosen to take that out and in favor of what we currently have. So,
got it.
You know, this wasn't just something that's like, oh, they should do it like this and we'll just keep it like that. There was a lot of thought into the how the game is just going to, aside from the gameplay, the design, just the look of it.
Yeah. No, and it looks like everything was so well placed. Nothing seems just arbitrary. You know, every room was so well designed by Tarsera that they wanted to make this the mall a living, breathing world.
Yeah. So like you can see all the stuff on the shelves. Clearly somebody has access to that.
I don't want to know who lives here. I'm kind of frightened to see who's in the next room.
So this is kind of a good little the developers have been really cognizant of trying to be very fair when it comes to the puzzles, because sometimes you play these type of games, like especially point and click games that aren't really fair. They just the answer is that way just because it is.
But, yeah.
And there's no way for you to really figure out other than try
everything. Like there's one way to solve the puzzle, right?
Yeah.
And there's not a lot of play there.
I mean, a lot of these are the same way, but the developers really try to breadcrumb you. So and this is like an early situation. So we have this electrified gate here, and
I love the sparks.
Yeah. Oh, and when she grabs it, can't hear it, but she's like,
oh no.
But there's this noise that kind of happens. Like it's really freaked
the
freaks
six
you out.
Killing simulator. I wanna read this comment from Devil Lady. She says, at Band and Namco US, I wanna thank you for the amazing experience with this game. I totally loved and it gave me a lot of feels. Thank you.
Yay,
thank you, Devil Lady. That's
you.
Very nice. And we're really glad that you enjoyed the game.
Yeah.
On that note, I think we need to give away a game.
So
someone else can experience it.
Wait, just before you go into that, just want to say, I'll finish that thought.
Oh, yeah, sure.
You have the gate, and if you look up, there's these wires there, and it's...
Oh, I see,
so this kind of training is like, oh, look around, because, oh, there could be something behind the door to help you solve this puzzle.
I see.
That's so smart.
So it's visually leading your eye to kind of help you find the solution.
Right.
Cool. Okay, so I'm going to roll again. This is for an Xbox One copy code of the game.
Oh, the lights went off.
Yes.
Freako 7.
Just kidding.
Freako 7. You have just won an Xbox One version of Little Nightmares.
Woo!
Congrats, man.
I would clap.
We'll DM you and get you your code. And as I said, to win the codes, guys, just stay active in the chat. Ask us questions about the game. Maybe if you've already played the game, I know it's been out today. So if you have your chance to play it, maybe how you're progressing in the game. Maybe there's some spots that you really like, or spots that maybe some puzzles you've been stuck on.
You know, somebody made that block tower and you just knocked it over.
There's a lot of.
And it's kind of rude.
And we're also doing the giveaway of the collector's edition that I unboxed earlier. We're giving away a PS4 and an Xbox One version of the collector's edition through Gleam. There's going to be a link in the chat, so just keep an eye out for that link to in the chat, and you'll have a chance to win the sixth edition.
Very nice.
So you solved the electrified gate puzzle.
Yeah, and I kind of skipped over too. Like you just probably saw that I ran through room.
A room full of toys.
Yeah, it's,
you're no fun.
You end up figuring out that you have to run in past that because there's a timer, so I can't make it out the other gate. And you know, I want the guys to see the game.
all right. I mean, I would have stopped to play with the toys, but that's just me.
As would I.
So yeah, this seems kind of so. There's. That's obviously some sort of surveillance light. That sort of someone's looking for you, watching for six.
Yeah, looking for a lot of. Yeah. And I don't want to spoil anything. What's going? What you end up kind of determining later in the game. But yes. But you never really understand how that thing works and why that. Like if you get caught in the light, you'll turn to stone, and it kind of explains something that you see later on in the game. But this world is very, very, very puzzling. Like I remember I was talking to a lot. We had focus test this game with gamers and. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I can't hear. Yeah. So I don't know how close he is. So I'm gonna hide.
I know it's always hard to play and speak at the same time. That's always a dilemma, especially when in a game where you're being chased by a giant long armed man.
Yeah.
Yeah. So one of the cool things about this game is that not only like Ray explained earlier, you have to use your eyes and you look around to find the solution, but you also have to use your ears. So in this case, you need to listen for the enemy to see, you know, how close he is, because if he's close by, you better hide.
Yeah.
But if he's not, then, you know, maybe you're safe.
Yeah, and as we mentioned earlier, there's really no way for Six to protect herself against that creature because she's such a small, defenseless girl. So hiding is really her best technique.
Yeah, yeah. And this particular guy, although he is blind, he has really long arms. So it's if he hears you, it's really hard. You can't hide under a table or even on a lot of shelves. He can reach really far. But he is blind, but he has a really good sense of smell. So you have to be very careful because even if you're super quiet, if he walks right by you, he'll know you're there.
Right, and Six probably smells really tasty, right?
Yeah.
So nobody important says maybe he's just lonely. Maybe he's looking for a friend out there in the mall.
Well, you know, if we get to that part, you will see some evidence that he is a little bit lonely. He is in search of some friends, but whenever he catches you, it doesn't end well. So.
He
could be a little bit.
The shadows.
Like the Abominable Snowman from those old Looney Tunes. He wants a friend.
He just wants a friend.
It's Mamie George.
Oh, so Six looks like she's dealing with some physical ailments here.
Some real hunger pangs.
Ah. She's hungry.
So for those of you that have kept up with this title, you would know that when this game was originally announced years and years ago, not even that long ago, it was originally called Hunger. And the title changed. Felt that Little Nightmares kind of encapsulated the different levels of content in the game itself.
Awesome. Yeah, it's a great title.
The exercise on selecting titles, for those of you that have never gone through it, it's a lot harder than you would think trying to come up with a good title for a game. We had a lot of contenders there.
CJ Wow is asking, are there any other children in the mall?
I got one from the, they just tossed me some food.
Oh, I see.
And where I just came from was a bit of a bedroom or a nursery, and it was full of children. That are, that were sleeping.
Oh, okay.
And I will probably get to a part that you will see that, where a bunch of children that weren't so fortunate that make it through the security system.
So people are asking about the price point. This game is $19.99. It's available on Xbox One, PS4, and PC via Steam. So
yep.
Any platform, whatever platform you play on, you have the option to pick it up. We're playing on PS4 here, just to let everybody know.
I still got it, but...
All right, another wide open room.
Yeah.
Ooh.
This is like another one of those things that you've got another electrified fence. Follow up the cord that can kind of point you to where to go.
I see. So visually, the developers kind of want you to investigate the room and kind of look for those breadcrumbs, as you mentioned.
Yeah, yeah. And it was just, to be fair, it's just to make you feel like that everything was intentional, because it really was.
Not only that, but look at this. What is this? It's basically a wall of cages.
It's like a kennel or something.
Yeah. And since Six is so small, she's able to climb up it. It's this whole place, presents a playground for her. She can climb and throw things. It's also very
Maybe scary, you could talk a little about the climbing mechanics, Ray. Kind of how it works.
So it's a little bit unconventional as far as the grab system. Most grab in games are a toggle. You push the grab button and then you grab.
Yeah.
You don't have to hold the button down.
Yeah.
But the grab button on this game is the R2 button, and you actually have to hold it down when you do it. The designers really wanted to give a physical sense of like actually grabbing with your hand, like as you're holding
like
control.
Like a visceral response. Yeah.
Because sometimes it's like very, very important for her. Like if you miss a grab, she's gonna fall through.
Yeah, I mean, like in this situation, if you don't hold on, she's
gonna
dead.
Fall.
Yeah. Yeah, I know when we were focus testing this around here, there was a lot of questions. It's like, this is a toggle. It's a hold instead of a toggle. And some thought that, maybe a toggle might be better. But I think that overall, in the sense that after discussing with a lot of the focus testers, it's like, I think the hold does feel like it has a bit more, you feel like you're holding
the response back to the player
as
well.
You get a little more connection. As little as it may seem, it really helps you connect with Six
and
what she's trying to do by physically doing the same thing that she is.
And when Six is under pressure to run away and climb things to get away from enemies, you are also trying to get away from these enemies, and you also have to hold on. So it definitely brings you into the game more.
Yeah.
Oh gosh.
Oh, nice.
Very good.
It's not race first. first trip through the mall.
Clearly.
You know, and singing, and you know, I don't want to give away too much Tuesday, so I'm trying to take it slow.
Yeah.
But you know, this is kind of a good spot to talk about is that this place has changed so much. This is a very much changed section of the game, and it's really interesting for this particular game of to know how much content was actually changed and cut and such. And you know, there could be one avenue of thought. It's like, oh well, we should have it so you have more gameplay. But the guys at Tarsha did a really good job because not, you know, more isn't always better.
Yeah, of course.
They have a really good focused flow of the game, the difficulty of the puzzles up and down.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things that actually didn't make it in the game, and you know, nothing. They weren't necessarily bad puzzles, but they just didn't fit the flow that we ended up with. So it was they had really did a great job of making sure that what you played was a directed experience.
Yeah.
Right. Not only that, but when we first announced the game last year, we had a demo at New York Comic Con, and it featured the bedroom with the two beds, and in that. That was back in the early development stages, but you know, it's completely changed from then.
Yeah.
So people who played the demo at New York Comic Con as well as PAX East in March,
yeah.
you know,
you're
going to have a different experience,
yeah.
and it's going to be good.
So this Amisfit is asking, are there any hidden items or secrets that encourage exploration or replays? You're mentioning the dolls.
Yeah. Do you want to mention that while I'm trying to remember how to get to this?
I will do it for you.
Do you remember how to get to this?
Yeah.
I just talked about changed content. This is one of the puzzles that changed very last, very close to the end of the game. I had played the game a lot more in the alpha and beta stages, and this changed very late, and I probably only saw this puzzle once. That's why off the top of my head, I don't remember how to do it.
Yeah.
But talking about collectibles, there are hidden gnomes throughout the game itself that if you need to find them, if you find them all, you'll get a little prize achievement or trophy.
A trophy? Okay.
Yeah, and again, talking about changed content, that actually collectible had changed a lot as well, too. It's really interesting to see how we ended up on the gnomes because it kind of... It kind of gives more purpose to the gnomes in the game, is that's what they're there for.
Yeah.
But we had actually, you know, we had other things there before that had, and I liked how they ended up on this.
Don't worry, I'm just a god of little.
Well, now that you completed that puzzle, I'm gonna do another roll. We're going to give away a PC version of the game for Steam. So here we go, roll it.
All right, I want to win.
Legend Assassin F.
Wow,
with a NES.
Okay.
He's got a NES. Super Smash Brothers logo or icon.
Nice.
You just won a Steam version of the game. We'll DM you shortly and get you that information.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Cool. So we're going to keep going with the game.
Okay.
For a bit longer.
There I am.
Keep your questions coming, guys. As I said, to win a code, you have to stay active in the chat. So please give us your questions. Let us know your thoughts about the game.
I have a question for the chat, actually.
Yeah, put it out there, Sumi.
What do you think brought Six here to the mall? I want to know your theories. What brought her here?
But no spoilers out there.
All right,
You've
no spoilers.
Played the game, but
if you play the game, then
oh, there was a gnome. So that's a gnome there, right, Ray?
That's not when you collect, though.
But that is a gnome.
Those are just benign creatures that are in the mall.
So people, Sumi's asking, what do you think brought Little Six to the mall, to this overwhelming, frightening world? Why is a little girl there? I guess that's really a big part of the game, too, is kind of uncovering that mystery, too, right?
Mm-hmm. But it's a lot of it is like, well, what do you think happened? Because The game may or may not give you a clear answer on any of that. That's why you.
Yeah, exactly. As we said earlier, you know, this is a very visual game. There's not any dialogue sequences. There's no text. So the player themselves infer what they want from the world. There's little clues and there's little small visual hints that kind of give you some context. But it's really up to the player to kind of build their own narrative, right?
Yeah, right. And that applies to even the enemies. You know, like when you're encountering these enemies in all of these different places in the mall, there's a whole bunch of different things that are littered around the room, and you basically use that to determine what kind of personality these enemies have, because they are, you see them as
wall.
You see them as enemies,
yeah,
but
yeah.
they have their own lives.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
know?
Yeah, you're in their bedroom. You see, I've seen, in certain areas, you'll see like pictures of their family.
Right.
Yeah, or they're just like a chef. He's just going about his day. He's just trying to make food.
He's
right.
He's just making some food.
And
yeah.
and Six just happens to be a tasty morsel in the maw. Right.
Right.
Yeah, it's really interesting how the guys over at Tarsier built the world. I mean, the world never, you never actually interact with it. It's actually not important to the what you do, like as Six going through, but it gives the world personality. And the mod definitely has that.
Some people were saying she wanted spaghetti.
She was
looking for her rain boots. That's why she doesn't have any shoes
she
on.
You're right. She doesn't have any shoes on.
Which creates a really interesting sound of I got bumped by that.
These death animations are brutal.
Oh, there are a bunch. Oh.
There are many ways for Six
so
to die.
So other than just the normal like I fell or I turned to stone, there's actually certain particular parts in the game if you get caught or die, you can get a special contextual death. I want to say there's maybe like six of them or six, seven, or eight of them. Maybe we can have something later on community
right.
if you like. Cause have you found all the contextual ways that Six can die?
We actually have a trailer on our YouTube page that shows some of the ways Six
right.
can die. There was one where
right.
she got
I forgot
stuffed
about
into
that.
A fish.
Yeah,
yes.
She gets stuffed into a fish, turned to stone, eaten by leeches, pulled down by all kinds of different creatures.
Yep. The leeches were in there too.
Oh yeah. So I'm gonna roll for another giveaway here. While Ray's trying to solve this puzzle, we're going to give away another PS4 version of the game. So good luck, everybody. Here we go. Chicken Fly. Chicken Fly?
That's not my name.
Congratulations, Chicken Fly. You just won a PS4 copy of Little Nightmares. We'll DM you and get you that code, man. Hope you enjoy the game.
Woo! Congrats. All right, you made it.
One question someone was asking about is there any maybe like a speed run possibility for this game?
Oh, absolutely.
There's absolutely a speed run opportunity here. All
yeah.
you speedrunners.
She knows a lot about speed running, so she can tell us all about it.
I love speed running.
I did actually take a shortcut early in the game. But,
oh, you did?
I did skip a part.
Oh, they're shortcuts.
Ray's a speedrunner now.
Yeah.
That's what's up.
What's your time right now, Ray? I don't know, you took a few deaths, so
well,
I might mess
there,
up your time.
There is an achievement associated with defeating the game in a certain amount of time. So, I actually haven't beaten it yet. But then again, I haven't really tried.
Nintendo Ninja, DM is a direct message. Oh, there's a first trophy there.
Yep, so I just finished...
That section, the prison.
The prison.
So we made it through the prison?
So it is a prison.
Yeah. Well, I guess that achievement gave us a little information about what's going on, huh?
Yeah.
So there is a prison in the maw. Why?
Well, what's the maw like? I really like that name, the maw. It's
yeah.
It's like just a mouth, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Just
but
some
then,
gaping.
But then if you're
yeah.
naming a place the maw, what kind of feelings and thoughts about a place that's called the maw? What does that make you think about it? And that's
it makes me think that I'm in the jaws of a monster. I
yeah,
guess.
Jaws of a monster. Very something that's really vast. Like you think, like the maw of a beast. Like it can open really wide.
Mm-hmm.
It's really dark.
Right.
In the mouth of a creature. Oh
or
wow!
Like,
look at
like,
the space
like Pinocchio
here.
And the whale, or
yeah,
whatever.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love the sense of space. And here, this. I mean, as you were saying, sometimes you're in these tiny little rooms. Sometimes you're in these vast staircases, or sometimes you'll see stuff far off in the background. So
right.
it's, yeah, as I said, it's kind of like got this Willy Wonka feel to it. Like you don't really understand the sense of space in
right.
the maw. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, there's no.
This guy, Dog Dude says the maw is like the asteroid in Star Wars.
Yeah.
I guess if you're in a giant worm.
This isn't an asteroid.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm pretty sure I'm butchering the line, but yeah, I got.
The Morholt says the maw is like being devoured by the void. That's pretty poetic, man.
So you just pulled that chair over to that. To that little switch there, the
yeah.
little hidden switch.
Yeah, there was.
Ooh.
And one thing I want to mention too is a lot of people are saying, the gameplay experience, length. If, this is a kind of game that requires a lot of problem solving and a lot of intuitive thinking. You have to go into each room, as Ray mentioned, think about the breadcrumbs. analyze the room, kind of figure out each move. So if you're a person that knows exactly what to do, of course that you're going to be much quicker at speedrunning it, but the first playthrough requires a lot of thought and requires you to kind of think critically and figure out exactly what's going on.
Right. Yep. Not only that, but I think that, you know, even a speedrun would be amazing, but I really think that the first time someone plays through the game, they should really take the time to explore and, you know, touch and feel everything in the game.
Yeah. I'm the kind of guy, personally, that when I play single-player games, it's not really about the time that I completed, it's more about did I enjoy every small aspect of the game. Because you never get your first playthrough back. You can always go back and play a game a second time, but I like that kind of full immersion in the first experience, really diving into the maw of the game.
Right.
What were you saying earlier, Ray?
What was I saying?
You were about to say something. Yes, you were.
So one, Level 6B Gaming is asking, are there any costumes for 6, like hidden outfits? That's a really good question. There actually are a few cosmetic masks that you can wear. Maybe Sui can touch on that.
I can. So there are a couple of different ways you can dress up 6. While she always wears her lovely raincoat, which I hope she never stops wearing, there's the option to wear different masks. So one of the masks that are available that you can still get right now is called the Tengu mask, and you can go to the website little-nightmares.com, do the Escape Kitchen web experience, and you can still get the Tengu mask.
That's ending soon though, right?
So it is ending soon. So
jump on it. That's little-nightmares.com. Play the interactive experience, which is an awesome web experience, and you have a chance to unlock the Tengu mask. And for people that don't know, Tengu is a Japanese Oni
with the big long nose.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
But really, there's also a couple of other things. There's a couple of other masks. If you pre-ordered the game, unfortunately, if you didn't pre-order the game before, you know, you may not get this bonus, but there is the option to have the Scarecrow mask, which is kind of like a burlap sack mask that covers her face. But there's also my personal favorite, which is the upside down teapot. It's a teapot.
That really fits with the game.
That's okay, my favorite.
Okay, so this is kind of what we were talking about earlier, right, Timmy? You're in this room, and who are these people on the wall? Kind of helps build backstory.
Yeah, this is the guy that was chasing
you earlier, right?
Or I was hiding from.
Is that his brother?
Well, it could be the janitor, but it's really cool, like how the room is set up. It's really kind of set up only for him.
Yeah, because everything's super high up.
Yeah, yeah.
While Ray tries to get this key, I'm gonna roll for another winner. I believe we're going to do Xbox next. So let me roll it up for Xbox.
I like the eye on the floor.
Oh yeah, that's a motif.
Nightshade Rose, awesome anime avatar. You just won a Xbox copy of Little Nightmares. Congratulations, Woo! Nightshade Rose.
Nightshade Rose.
Cool.
That's
name,
cool,
too.
Yeah, that is a cool name.
And it perfectly fits with the feel of this game. So this is something I really like, is 6 is so small, right, that everything has weight to it. Right. You know, even the key is small, but she's such a tiny, tiny little girl that to move that key, she has to carry it. I love her animation, kind of how the it weighs her down. She has to put it up on the ledge and climb back up because she can't jump up that with the key.
Come on, Ray, put some muscle in it.
Oomph.
All right. I really like the sound that it makes. When I first did that, the sound kind of freaked me out.
So actually, these kind of things used to freak me out. Because I don't know if you guys remember in the late 80s, there was a series of movies. I think it was Puppet Master.
Oh yeah, I love the Puppet Master movies.
Yeah, I think didn't they have one of these monkey guys here?
Yeah.
They can come alive. I think he had like
Full Moon Entertainment, man.
Nice,
they make all those old
was
Puppet
that?
Master. Yeah, they did a whole
Puppet
bunch
Master,
of B horror,
the Gate
flicks.
And stuff like that.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
Man, I love my dad.
The Brood,
The Brood,
all those really kind of B horror flicks.
Brood. I remember The Brood.
I feel like this game kind of takes some nods from that atmosphere a little bit. Yeah,
absolutely. I mean, there's a lot of reanimator I see in some of the design for like the chefs and stuff.
Yeah. All right, guys, I'm gonna roll again for another giveaway. I'm gonna do a Steam code. This is our final Steam code giveaway. But as I said, you still have the chance to win on the Gleam. And on the Gleam, we're giving away an Xbox One and a PS4 version of the 6 edition that I showed earlier. So here we go. I'm gonna roll for the Steam code. Here we go.
help, it's me.
It's rolling.
It doesn't need to be me because
Mars Hill
gave me a. They gave me one of those.
Mars Hill, congrats, man.
Sixth edition.
Woo!
Sitting on my desk.
I have a sixth edition on my desk as well.
Awesome. So, as we said, everyone, Little Nightmares is out today on PS4, Xbox One, and PC via Steam. So, if you're interested in horror games, really atmospheric games, games that are kind of a new IPs, trying brand new experiences, I'd highly recommend it. Games that really kind of test your puzzle solving knowledge, but also your kind of your really resilience to fear as well, because you know this game's big on kind of pushing against your childhood fears.
Right.
You know, going into dark locations, running away from grotesque creatures, trying to find the best way to kind of escape this really overwhelming world, which I think we can all appreciate in our own lives. So, I think maybe this is a good place to stop. I know this is a pretty big moment. So. Thank you guys all for tuning in. We're gonna do a little send off here. At the end, we got a special guest coming in, the one, the only, Jason Enos, Amanda Jason. Namco legend,
my boss.
He's gonna come in. He's been working on Little Nightmares for a long time. He's a huge fan of the game. Just a huge proponent of the Bandai Namco community, the fan base.
Yeah.
He's been helping us all out for years and years and years, and we wanted to bring him on and. Unfortunately, it's his last day here at the Bandai Namco office, so we wanted him to come on and do a send-off, and I wanted everyone to show their appreciation. How long have you been working here?
Just about to finish 7 years.
Seven years. So he's seen a lot of your favorite titles, guys. He's been managing the brands, managing the teams, the development. So we all want to just, you know, give him a send-off, send him off right. And I know he spent a lot of time, a lot of labor, a lot of love to put Little Nightmares out into the world. So let's all give him a round of applause here.
thank you. It's always every title that we've worked on in the time I've been here, you know, getting a chance to be able to speak about it and bring it out to the fans, bring it out to you guys, has always been one of the best parts. And I started originally working on Namco line and the stuff like Ace Combat and Splatterhouse. You know, there's a lot of fans out there that love that. Speaking of dark games.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of carryover and Little Nightmares in the Splatterhouse.
Yeah, exactly. A little bit of learnings went into this. But then, you know, got a chance to work on Bandai line where we've got, you know, our great anime titles like Dragon Ball and Naruto, all the awesome anime content. And then a little bit of everything between Dark Souls, new exciting franchises like Little Nightmares, which is really special to Bandai Namco.
Yeah, you know, we're all really excited about this game.
Yeah.
You know, it's always great to help bring something, a new experience, new characters, a new world for fans to drop into. So.
I was gonna say, quite honestly, you know, these days it's becoming more and more rare to find, you know, game companies that are willing to bring out brand new content and brand new game ideas. It gets a lot more challenging, you know. And you know, we really loved the look and feel of Little Nightmares. We really loved what it was trying to do. It has such a, you know, just an iconic theme and art style, and just all the different mix of gameplay mechanics, puzzle solving, action, side scrolling, platformer, you know, stealth. There's just a little bit of everything in there. So even if you're, you know, a gamer that might not normally play a game like this, I think you'll find a lot of elements in this game that match some of the elements that you like from other games. And it's well worth the compelling experience to find out what happens to Six and find out if she does escape the Maw and get out. So really excited Little Nightmares is out today. I mean, I know you guys probably already touched on this stuff already, but you know, for me, you know, being that this is, you know, my last day and essentially my last broadcast, you know, at Bandai Namco.
Captain Eno signing off.
So happy to do it with the release of Little Nightmares, a brand new game from us, a brand new vision, a great potential for the future. So appreciate everybody's support through the years, and Bandai Namco is going to keep on impressing you guys and bringing the best games that we possibly can.
Well, thanks so much, Jason. to all the fans, including myself. I've been a fan for a long time. So thank you so much for all you've done for the company and everyone here. We all love you, man. So
thank you.
Yeah, it's actually thanks to you that I was able to work on Little Nightmares because you. I don't know if I should say this, but basically what happened was that you were telling me, you were saying, hey, I know a game that I think you would love.
Yeah.
Perfect. And
yeah.
You said it was perfect for me.
Yes.
And you said, oh, because it's really dark, like you.
Sumi's dark core.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, yes. But truth be told, you know, for the people watching the stream is that, you know, Kasumi told me early on when she was very interested to come work here, the types of games that she liked. And although at the time, I didn't tell her that we have this game, but I could kind of put two and two together and I knew it would be a great match making in heaven. And so I really appreciated also your support and Ray too, you know, working on this game. It's been a great partnership to get this game out. And you know, a lot of hard work goes into bringing games to you guys.
Definitely.
And a lot of talented people work on it, you know, hours and hours and hours on end. And, you know, we're just a small sample of the folks that brought Little Nightmares. But we're really, really excited, collectively celebrating with you guys. They're playing it probably right now and not watching the stream.
Yeah.
That this game has come out. So we're really, really pleased. Yeah. And
been a lot of stress the last month.
Yeah.
Yeah, you could say we had a lot of little nightmares just internally.
Right.
And some of those ones became bigger.
Yeah.
But ultimately, what came out of this, you know, from Tarshir and from us is a game that we really, really, really hope you guys will enjoy.
Yeah, we're proud of it. We're really happy about the critical response. You know, 8.8 from IGN, 9 from Game Informer. You know, lots of YouTubers, influencers, streamers I know are loving the game so far. So for us here at Bandai Namco US to get that response back, we're super excited. So we really urge anyone that, as we've been talking about, he's looking for a new experience. You know, it's Friday. Yeah. It's the weekend. If you're looking to kind of immerse yourself into a dark world, maybe not go out in the sun this weekend. this is the game for you. So thanks to everyone for tuning in. And once again, final send off to Captain Enos, the legend. We'll see him around now. You'll see him around. So
guaranteed.
See you guys. Thanks so much for tuning in.
Bye.
Just one more thing. The Gleam is going to be up for the next. Till 10 p.m. So if you still want to enter to win the sixth edition, you still have the chance. And also, we'll be back on Monday, May 1st at 3 p.m. doing Tekken Talk, talking about Tekken 7. We'll have Mark Mann, Mark Julio, as well as Maximilian Dude, two masters of the fighting game community on. We're going to be showing new gameplay, new modes, character customization, you name it. So stay tuned to our channels and stay tuned for more great gaming content. See you guys.
Bye. Have a great weekend, guys.